am Thomas. I'm the head of the business department here. I'm also a member of the reunion class, along with many of you in the class of 1982. And it is my extraordinary privilege this morning to kick off this historic event. I cannot overstate my joy and gratitude for the program we have this morning. So let me get things rolling by introducing my fellow alumnus, Kasim Lucas.
So first I'm going to start with, I guess, love for George School. And for those who know me may understand this, I had Yankee tickets today. So I should be tailgating in a parking lot in the Bronx right now. I also have my firm's tickets to the Sixers game later this afternoon, which I'm not going to go to. And today is my birthday. So I'm here. Even though my mind may be in other places. Just kidding. So for those who don't know me, my name is Kasim Lucas, class of 1990. Also served as a faculty member here at George School from 94 right out of college to 2005. In which was a year that Nancy kicked me out of the dorm. I don't own an apartment. That is good. But she invited me onto the board, so I've been serving on the board ever since, with the exception of 1 year. So that's me. I want to talk a little bit about my role on the board. Sometime, I can't remember how long ago, maybe like 6 to 7 years ago, Nancy and I talked about adding a diversity oversight committee as a board level committee, which I was happy to. Everybody knows George School is a diverse place, mostly because that man over there, David Warren's pushing diversity. And of course, Nancy continued the tradition, and I've seen John here. John Huffman, where's John? Is John here? John, who's responsible for, you know, hundreds of kids coming in through George School with the Alumni program, myself being one of them from New York City. So I want to give all three of them a round of applause. So we started this diversity oversight committee, and I became the chair of it, and I still serve as the chair. And one of the things we did was think about how we can continue sort of the tradition of George School after we leave, specifically with students of color. So we created the Sid Carpenter Network 3 years ago, named after Sid Carpenter, George School's first black student. And unfortunately, she can't be here today because she has a granddaughter graduating from college today. And Adriana is going to come up and say a few words that Sid said to us. So we started this network, really, and you know, it's funny, we've been doing this for 3 years, and I still get alone saying, I never heard about this. So we're working hard to get the word out. And really it's just to kind of connect and network us with each other. Anyone can join, obviously. Also, and I think more importantly, trying to connect back to the school, to the kids who are here, being support. Because I know when I was here, I had that support from people like Nate, Vince, Lise, my teachers, and my coaches. So I think it would be good to have our alum connect as well to the students. So we want to get that word out to everyone and have everyone join so we can continue to network with each other. So when I was at George School teaching, Tom English asked me if I wanted to teach an African American history course. I was like, great, of course. And I think Tom is retiring this year too, so I thank Tom for that. And I believe the course is still in the curriculum. So when I was teaching, you know, I love sports, but when I started teaching African American history, I really started to learn about the real history, the real heroes, the people who did so much for us, for this country, for me to stand here. And of course, one of the people that I learned about was Julian Bond. And I think about when I was teaching it, I was relatively the same age as he was when he was getting started with SNCC in the 60s and getting, you know, civil rights on the ground. And And I was sort of floored when I actually got him. One, I realized that he was a George Cook graduate. And two, when we actually got to meet him when he came to visit the George Cook. So I think it's a great, great thing that we have this portrait that we're going to unveil. And I thank you all for coming. And I'm going to bring up Adriana now to talk, to give a message from Sid.
I'm Adriana Sophie. I am in the class of 03, so this is my 15-year reunion, so I'm very excited to be here. I see a lot of my homies in the back. All right. So this is a message from Sid Carpenter. Good morning. I'm sending my greetings by email today. My children, Jan and Jeffrey, have been with me during Alumni Weekend the past 2 years. We thoroughly enjoyed being on a beautiful campus, which held for me so many lovely memories. I especially loved when several of the students of color came up to me and said, thanks for doing this, because otherwise I could not be here. This year, 2018, Jan's daughter, Naima Tucker, is graduating from the University of California, Santa Cruz. So we will be traveling there shortly. I'm sorry that I can't be with all of you as well. We congratulate the graduates, the retirees as well, as they move on to the next phase in their lives. I want to send a special thanks to the 300 students who joined the surge of youth calling attention to the need to end gun violence in our country. It may take some time to achieve, but these wonderful youth are on their way, sorry. So go for it. Thanks again to the art teacher, Joe Adachi, for the wonderful experience and in capturing my likeness. Special greetings to Mrs. Julian Bond, whose husband's portraits will be joining the other pioneers as recognized by Nancy Starma, displayed on the George Will campus. Thank you. And this is from Cynthia Brooks Carpenter, class of 1947.
So, Adriana serves as a clerk of the Sid Carpenter Network. And I serve as a vice clerk. So you can reach out to any one of us about signing up. We should have some sign up sheets printed and copied for people to write in. Otherwise, it's a survey you need that I can send you as well. So without further ado, I'm going to bring up our George Cook class of 2017, who's still in college at the University of Pittsburgh, Richard Norris, who, my understanding, was spearheaded the move to get this portrait done. So, Richard.
Good morning. To our esteemed head of schools, Ann Hauser, and to former heads of school, Bourne and Starmer, to all of the faculty, staff, students, and other members of our beloved community, and to Miss Cynthia Crooks Carpenter in Essential, who every black student at GS owes a debt of gratitude. And certainly to all my brother and sister alumni, I am excited, very happy to be here in this moment. I cannot express all of my thanks and appreciation for the opportunity to be here. I will not forget this moment for the rest of my life. It was my immense pleasure to give 4 years of my life to this beloved school. I'll never forget the doors that were opened and the ways that were made for me as a result of my time here. But while I am eager and excited about the future, I also understand the great importance of remembering and honoring the past. Just as the roots of a tree give it a solid foundation, so too were we given a solid foundation by those who came before us. As a student in Tom Hoop's Peace Studies class, while my mind was beginning to shift into senioritis mode, I was challenged to find an injustice somewhere on campus and propose and possibly implement a solution. My mind instantly traveled back to a student council meeting during my junior year. Early in the year, the council discussed how all around campus there were hardly any paintings of people of color. For example, for the majority of my time here in main lobby, hanging on either side of the great mirror that faces the admissions office, there were two giant portraits of William Penn and George Fox, two old, dead white men. We began brainstorming ideas of people of color whose portraits could hang on campus, and our minds instantly turned to Julian Bond. And a task force was created to commission a portrait of Bond, but sadly this goal was not accomplished and was never brought up to the council again. And the old adage is true that if you can't find somebody else to do something, when you want something done right, do it yourself. So for my injustice project, I was determined to set the ball in motion for a portrait of Julian Bond to be painted and hung somewhere on campus. I spoke to our resident artiste, Joe Adachi, who agreed to paint the portrait. And then I spoke to our head of school, Sam Hauser, who told me that the school would pay for the portrait, which I was very relieved because when Joe told me the price, and I was like, yeah. And now here we are. What a beautiful and joyous day this is. As I said before, we cannot move into our future without remembering our past. And as we stand on the precipice of welcoming a new generation of GS students, it is my sincere hope and prayer that some Black student who may be feeling like they were a blip in the admission system, who may be feeling like they landed here by accident, who may be thinking that they're not smart enough or cultured enough or good enough, will look at this portrait and ask, who was Julian Bond? And they'll learn about this great civil rights giant who came here in the fall of 1953. They'll learn about how Bond credits GS with teaching him about nonviolent social activism and how he took those teachings during his college years and became one of the leaders of the student nonviolent coordinating committee, serving as its spokesman. They'll learn about how he kept up the fight for justice, helping found the Southern Poverty Law Center and becoming the chair of the NAACP and serving in the Georgia House of Representatives and Senate. They'll understand that they're not that different than Julian Bond. They'll realize that Bond walked the same paths they walked, sat in the same seats they sat, played on the same fields that they played, and they can be just like him and maybe even do greater works if they put their minds to it. Yes, I'm glad that this portrait is finally here, for I believe it will help awaken the champions for human rights that might be sleeping in the hearts and souls of some of our Black GS students. In these very troubling times full of alternative facts and fake news, it is our duty to remind the world that we will not be silent and we will not be satisfied until justice rolls down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. We have to remind the world that we still know the lyrics of freedom and the melody of protest, and just like the songwriter said, we ain't gonna let nobody turn us around. We're gonna keep fighting until we can't fight anymore. We won't stop until no Black boy has to fear for his life when he is interacting with law enforcement, and no Black girl is taught to be ashamed of her dark hair or her curly our dark skin on our curly hair. Even if we fall down 9 times, we'll get up 10 because we understand that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it will always bend towards justice. We understand that the light of God is within every being on this earth, and as long as we allow this light to shine within us, it will always shine brighter than the darknesses of racism, sexism, classism, and any other form of hatred or oppression there is. We have a responsibility to let our lives speak as loudly as we possibly can, because each of us has the capability to change the world one person at a time. We have a responsibility to help liberate our brothers and sisters from the chains of oppression and injustice wherever it is. And that is why we honor those who came before us. Because of them, we are, and because of them, we can. Because there was a Sid Carpenter, there was a Julian Bond. And because there was a Julian Bond, there was a Richard Norris III. Spirit of Mamie Till Mobley when she had gotten the news about her son in Mississippi, and they brought his body back to Chicago, and they went to the funeral home, and she saw what had happened to her baby boy, and she turned to the funeral director, and he said, are we going to have an open or closed casket funeral? And he said, she said, no, we're going to have an open casket funeral. And then he said, do you want me to do something with his face? Do you want me to fix his face? And they said, and she said, no, let the world see what I've seen, because they need to see what they did to my boy. And I say to you all, the George School needs to see what can become of a George School graduate. We need to see that if we invest in young people now, they can go on and do great and wondrous things. And so I'm just glad to be in the number this morning as we honor the life, legacy, and works of the Honorable Julian Bond. He let his life speak. And it is my sincere hope and prayer that all those who look upon his portrait will be encouraged to let their light speak too. Please welcome Zero Adasi. Pam Horowitz, Julian Bond's widow, was unable to be with us today, but hear her words. Julian would regard the unveiling of his portrait as a high honor, as do I. Julian always spoke fondly of George School, and I know how greatly he valued his experience there. We were amazed how often we ran into other George School graduates at various events across the country. Most recently, during a trip to Vietnam, I went to the Mine Action Visitor Center, which provides information on the war and its consequences. There, displayed prominently on one wall, was a photo of visiting George School students, confirming my belief that George School is everywhere. I thank you very much for valuing my husband as he valued you. Fondly, Pam Horowitz.